Okay, 3.2, angles and parallel lines. I forgot to put in objective, but we're going to learn the properties of parallel lines cut by a transversal. So we've already talked about how to name these different pairs of angles. The first thing we talked about is the corresponding angles. So we got 1 and 5, 2 and 6, 3 and 7, 4 and 8. Those are all corresponding. But if a transversal intersects two parallel lines, so in this situation the parallel, that's what these little arrows mean, then corresponding angles are going to be congruent. So in this situation, we got angle 2 is congruent with angle 6. And hopefully you can see all the other angles that pair up. So you got 1 and 5, so here you're going to put a 1, and with 7 you got 3, and with 4 you got 8, because those are all the angles that are in the same corner, so those are all congruent to each other. From this, we can actually prove some other theorems. So I'm going to tell you the theorems, and then we're going to prove them later. So the next theorem is, if a transversal intersects two parallel lines, then alternate interior angles are congruent. So alternate interior are going to be congruent as well. So 3 is alternate interior with 6. 3 and 6 are congruent. And 5 is congruent with 4. So 5 and 4 are congruent, because those are both alternate interior. Let's go to the next page. All right, so the next one is the same side interior angle theorem. And that says if a transversal intersects two parallel lines, then same side interior angles are, if they're same side interior, they're actually going to be supplementary. So that would mean that 3 and 5 are going to add up to 180, and angles 4 and 6 add up to 180. So these two are supplementary, and these two are supplementary. All right, so we're actually going to do this proof here. It says write a two-column proof for theorem 3.1. So we're actually going to prove that alternate interior angles are congruent. So we're going to prove that 3 and 6 are congruent. We're going to prove that 4 and 5 are congruent. So the given is just that AB is parallel to CD, and EF is a transversal of AB and CD. And so normally you would just rewrite this. Do as I say, not as I do. You'd rewrite that right there. And then that reason would just be given. And what else do we know by looking at this? Well, remember that we can use postulates in theorems, and we just learned a postulate. And we learned that all the corresponding angles are congruent. So I'm going to list those. I'm going to say that angle 1 is congruent to angle 5. And I'm going to say that angle 2 is congruent to angle 6. Angle 3 is congruent to angle 7. And lastly, angle 4 is congruent to angle 8. And we know that that's all true because they're all corresponding angles. So that is the corresponding angle postulate. Okay. Now, the next step is actually going to be, well, what else do we know? So we know 1 and 5, 3 and 7, 4 and 8, 2 and 6. What else do we know is congruent just by looking at this thing? What other information do we know? Well, I know that I have vertical angles here and here, here and here, here and here, and here and here. So I'm going to list all the vertical angles that are congruent. So I'm going to say, hey, 1 is also congruent to angle 4. 2 is congruent to angle 3. 5 is congruent to angle 8, and angle 6 is congruent to angle 7, and I know that by the vertical angles theorem. Alright, now let's follow some logic here. I got 1 to 5 and 5 to 8, and I also have an 8 over here, so that's the same. And I also have a 1 and a 4 over here. So all the red ones are going to be the same. So let's mark them in here. So 1 is congruent to 5. And we know that 5 is congruent to 8. And we know that 4 is also congruent to 8. Okay, now look, all the blue ones are going to be the rest. So I know that 2 is congruent with 6. That 6 is congruent to 7, because of vertical. And that 7 is congruent to 3. So all of those are the same as well. Alright, now, how am I going to make my last statement? I want to say that 3 is congruent to 6 and 4 is congruent to 5. So 3 is congruent to 6 and angle 4 is congruent to angle 5. And this would be like the red ones and this would be the blue ones. How can I say that? Well, this is the idea. If 1 is congruent to 5, and 4 is congruent to 1, can't I just say 5 to 1, 1 to 4, so we could skip the middleman and go straight to, from 5 to 4? And that's what I did here, and that would be the transitive property. Or I could also say, hey, 4 is congruent to 8, 8 is congruent to 5, skip the middleman, 4 to 5. Either way, it's the transitive property of congruence. There we go. There's the proof. Not too bad. I would definitely take a look at that, make sure you understand it, because you're going to see ones like that on tests and quizzes. Okay, this is also a type of question that you're going to see. And I'd recommend that you just take a look at it first and see if you could figure out any ideas on how to solve it. And a lot of people are going to say, oh, this is 125, then this is 125, because they're corresponding or something, but they're not. These are two different transversals, so they're not even intersecting this... Yeah, these two lines are parallel, but they're intersecting two different lines. There's no real way to do it. Here's the trick. If you want to pause the video and think about it for a while, I'd recommend it. It's good for your brain. But I'm going to go ahead and tell you the trick. At least this is how I do it. I add a third line right down the middle. When I do that, now I have three parallel lines. And I look at just the first two. Now I have two parallel lines that have the same transversal. So these angles are corresponding now. So are these. These are vertical. And I got all the angles that I need. I don't have these angles down here, but that's okay. I don't need them yet. So let's zoom in. If this angle is 125 and these two lines are parallel, then this angle right here has to be 125 as well. Well, if that's 125, this is a straight line, so this angle here needs to be its supplement. So 180 minus 125 is going to be 55. And remember, this whole angle is 119. So I can do 119 minus 55 to get me this angle, because these two angles should add up to 119. So that means that this angle has to be 64. 64 plus 55 is 119. Alright, now I have an angle here. Well, take a look. This line is parallel with this line, and they both have this transversal. That makes this angle and this angle corresponding angles of parallel lines. So angle 1 has to be 64 degrees. And I found it. So there's other problems like that. And there might be other ways to do it. That's the way that I do it. Easiest way I found. If you found another way and you got 64, I'd really like for you to show it to me in class so that we can see if it'll work all the time. Because maybe your way is simpler. All right. What I want you to do for your summary is, let's say you had two parallel lines and a transversal, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. If I told you that this angle was 60 degrees, I want for you to describe, not just do it, but I want for you to describe how you would find every other angle here. So tell me what properties you would use to get each angle and how you would do it. So how would you go from 2 to 1, or 2 to 4, or 2 to 6, to find all the other angles? So take a look at that, give that a try, and I'll see you guys on the next video.